Hello students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Savita Sharma from University of Delhi. Today we are going to study in this module about the sun basic data under the paper Astronomy and Astrophysics. So students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module. First of all, you will be able to explain how the temperature of the solar surface can be found by assuming that the sun radiates like a black body. This is a good assumption, but not completely valid. Then secondly, you will realize that Wien's displacement law can be applied as the peak wavelength of the solar spectrum is known. Thirdly, you will understand how the use of the distance to the sun and the known luminosity can lead to the determination of its temperature via the Stefan-Boltzmann law. The color index of the sun can also lead to its surface temperature. Then you will discuss while the temperature of the solar surface found by different methods is slightly different. You will argue that the photosphere, that is the layer of the sun which radiates most of the light, is so bright that the upper thin layers of the sun's atmosphere cannot be seen unless it is blocked, as it happens naturally during a total solar eclipse. Before we get into the details, let's have a brief introduction. In our previous module, we discussed some basic parameters which characterize the sun. The first parameter to be discussed was the distance of the sun from the Earth, a quantity called astronomical unit. This distance plays a key role in estimating the mass and luminosity of the sun. Then we discuss the attempts made by ancient astronomers using transits of planets in front of a solar disk to estimate the sun's distance from the Earth. We also discussed how they used a particular phase of the moon and moon's distance from the Earth for this purpose. Then we discussed the modern method of finding this distance. Using the distance of the sun, we could estimate the mass of the sun by equating the centripetal force acting on the Earth and the gravitational force of the sun, which holds Earth in its orbit. Another parameter that could be found using the distance was the radius of the sun. It is easy to find the angular diameter of the sun, and multiplying it with the distance of the sun, the size of the sun could be accurately calculated. Yet another important parameter, luminosity of the sun, was also discussed. The energy falling per second on a square meter of a surface placed outside the Earth's atmosphere, normal to the rays of the sun, is called the solar constant. So, if we draw a sphere of radius equal to 1 astronomical unit centered on the Earth, each square meter of its surface receives energy equal to the solar constant. Multiplying the total surface area of this sphere by the solar constant enables us to calculate the total energy emitted by the sun every second. That is, we call it as a luminosity of the sun. Just to digress a bit, variations in the solar constant were also discussed, since they may be important in connection with the weather and climate change on the earth and global warming we are witnessing today. An important data for the sun is its surface temperature or effective temperature, which we are going to discuss in the present module. There are several methods by which the temperature of the solar surface can be determined. So the first method by which the temperature of the solar surface can be determined is by using Wien's displacement law. Using Wien's displacement law, which states that the peak wavelength in a spectrum of an object is related to the temperature of the object by the following relation, that is lambda peak multiplied by temperature T is equal to constant. We all know that the peak of the blackbody spectrum is displaced towards longer wavelengths or the lower frequencies as the temperature of the object decreases. The value of the constant has been determined to be 2.898 into 10 to the power minus 3 mk. The peak of the solar spectrum has been found to be at wavelength lambda equals to 483 nanometer. Using these values, the solar temperature is found to be or calculated to be 6000 Kelvin. The figure shown here shows the blackbody curves at different temperatures and their peak wavelengths shown by vertical lines. We can notice that the shift of peak wavelength to longer wavelengths at the lower temperatures. The law is based, that is the Wien's displacement law is based on the blackbody curve, and it is the relation between the wavelength at the peak with the temperature, lambda peak into T equal to 2.898 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 mk. The next method to measure the, or the methods by which the temperature of the solar surface can be determined, is by using the Stefan-Boltzmann law. According to this law, solar length is equals to 4 into pi into solar radius square into sigma into solar temperature to the power 4. That is, L equals to 4 pi r square into sigma T to the power 4. The figure shown here shows the solar spectrum, that is the solar radiation at the top of the terrestrial atmosphere, which shows that the peak wavelength is 483 nanometer. The source of this spectrum is the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. We have already found in our previous module that the value of solar L is equals to 3.82 into 10 to the power 26 watts and solar radius equals to 6.96 into 10 raised to the power 8 meter. The Stefan's constant has the value 5.67 into 10 raised to the power minus 8 watt per meter square per Kelvin 4. Using all these values or using this data, we get solar temperature, or you can say the temperature of the solar surface to be 5768 Kelvin. So from this solar spectrum shown in the figure below, we can see the peak of the solar spectrum is at 483 nanometer. The next method to find the solar temperature or the temperature of the solar surface is by fitting a black body curve to solar spectra. In this method, we fit various black body curves to the observed solar spectrum and then choose the one that fits best. This fitting has been done in the figure given here. The best fit gives the effective solar surface temperature as 5777 Kelvin. The implication is that a perfect black body at this temperature and of the same size as the sun will emit the same amount of energy as the sun does. Now we discuss below the extent to which the sun may considered be as a black body. So the figure shown here is the black body curve fitted to the solar spectrum. Let's recall, we had defined the color index of a star as Ci equals to B minus V or MB minus MV, where B and V are apparent magnitudes in blue and visual bands. MB and MV are the absolute magnitudes in these bands. It was shown that the color index is related to the effective temperature of the star. A relation was also derived assuming that the star radiates like a black body, which you can see in the figure given below. The figure given here shows the relationship between the color index and the effective temperatures of stars. However, an empirical approximation suggested by Balestro, New Insights into Black Bodies, that is the name of his research, it gives T equals to 4600 multiplied by bracket starts 1 upon 0.92 into B minus V plus 1.7 plus 1 upon 0.92 into B minus V plus 0.62. This equation gives much better results for the stellar temperatures. The color index of the sun has been recently estimated to be 0.653. Using this value in the above equation of T, we can get solar temperature to be about 5770 Kelvin. If we assume that a star radiates like a black body, then one can calculate it, the temperature or at different wavelengths of the electromagnetic spectrum. The difference between the blue and visual magnitudes is called the color index of the star. The color index of a star is intimately related to its effective surface temperature. The color index of the sun has been estimated to be 0.653. This color index translates into an effective temperature of the sun as 5770 Kelvin. Now let us see the various measurements, or let us comment on the various measurements. We have noticed that all these methods yield different results. The reason is that we assumed that the sun radiates like a black body. This is only an approximation, though it is a very good approximation. If the sun were in complete thermal equilibrium, it would radiate like a black body. in that case, the temperature would be uniform all over. However, it is not so. The energy that is produced in the interior of the sun must filter to the surface, creating a temperature gradient, howsoever that gradient is very small. Then, the process of dissociation and recombination taking place in the emitting layer of the sun or the photosphere, which produce emission and absorption lines, and background spectrum of the sun make it deviate slightly from an ideal black body. Considering all these factors, the temperature 5778 Kelvin has been adopted as the effective surface temperature of the sun. Then we recall that the sun is a main sequence star, which is about 5×10⁻⁹ years old. It is estimated that it will live another 5×10⁹ years, so that its main sequence age is about 10×10⁹ years. As long as the sun is on the main sequence, it will burn hydrogen in its core to synthesize helium. There will be little change in its effective temperature. However, as hydrogen is replaced in the core by helium, a slight reduction in volume takes place. This brings about gravitational contraction and consequent release of gravitational energy causes the effective temperature to increase gradually, which is shown in the figure given below. The figure here shows the variation of the luminosity, radius, and temperature of the sun with its age, where luminosity is represented by red line, radius by blue line, and the temperature of the sun by green line. When all the hydrogen in the core is consumed, hydrogen burning in the core will cease and the sun will undergo an expansion and its surface temperature will decrease rapidly. The increase in the radius of the sun at the end of its life on the main sequence will result in the increase of its luminosity, because the R square factor will overtake the T⁴ factor in the Stefan-Boltzmann law. So the present age of the sun has been estimated to be 5×10⁹ years, and it is likely to live for another 5×10⁹ years. At present, the sun is on the main sequence, burning hydrogen, converting into helium. It is in a steady state, and so far in its history, its luminosity, temperature, and radius have not changed much.
As long as hydrogen is available in its core for nuclear reactions, the sun will remain on the main sequence. When the hydrogen is completely converted to helium in the core, the nuclear reactions in the core will cease. However, in a thin shell surrounding the core, conditions are still right for burning hydrogen. The energy generated by these nuclear reactions pushes pressure on the surface and the sun expands. The radius of the sun increases, but its surface temperature decreases. It becomes a red star. The luminosity of the sun increases manifold, as shown by the graph in the previous slide.
The chromosphere. Just above the photosphere, there is a layer about 2000 km thick, which becomes visible for a very brief period, just before total eclipse and just after the totality, as a pink hue. The hue is due to the emission of hydrogen atoms, or H alpha line. This emission is possible
at the temperatures found in the chromosphere, which vary between 6000 Kelvin and 20,000 Kelvin. The spectrum obtained during this brief period is called the flash spectrum, which shows emission lines. Chromosphere is the seat of a lot of solar activity caused by the magnetic field of the sun, and we will discuss this activity later. So the figure given here shows the flash spectrum of the sun. This colorful spectrum is seen at the time of total solar eclipse and belongs to chromosphere, the layer above the photosphere. The surface which radiates most of the energy and which appears as a disk to us is called photosphere. There are two layers of the sun's atmosphere above the photosphere. These layers are very faint and are not visible in the presence of a bright solar disk. When the disk is blocked, either naturally or during an eclipse or artificially, these layers become visible for a very short time. The spectrum obtained during this time is called flash spectrum, which is shown in the figure below. The emission lines in the flash spectrum indicate that the temperature in the chromosphere is quite high. Chromospheric temperature has been estimated to be in the range 6000 to 20,000 Kelvin. So the figure here is the solar chromosphere spectrum.
When the totality of the eclipse is complete, a beautiful crown-like structure appears around the sun. This structure is called the solar corona, or literally a crown, which you can see in the figure given here. The shape of the crown varies according to the level of solar activity caused by its magnetic field. The accompanying photograph is at the time of maximum solar activity.
During the totality, the spectrum of the corona can be obtained. So first of all, let us see what is a corona. The uppermost layer of the solar atmosphere is known as corona, which we saw in the previous slide, which appears like a crown for a short time during the total solar eclipse. The corona at times may extend to as large a distance as the Earth. Its density is very low. That is why it is very faint and visible only at the time of total eclipse. The shape of the corona at the maximum of solar activity is different from the one at the time of the minimum activity. The origin of this difference can be traced to the varying solar magnetic field. We shall discuss this later along with the rest of the solar activity. During totality, the spectrum of the corona can be obtained, which is shown in the figure given here. One of the features, the emission line in the green region of the spectrum at 530.3 nanometer was a mystery for a long time, as it did not match with any known line of any element. Astronomers even coined a name of the element they thought gives this line. The name proposed was coronium. However, it was shown in 1930 that line was due to the familiar element iron, which had been stripped of 13 of its electrons. Such high state of ionization could be possible only at very high temperatures. It led to the conclusion that the temperature of the corona was as high as a few million degrees Kelvin.
So the figure given here shows the spectrum of solar corona. It shows the emission lines of various species of atoms as identified here.
So students, let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. We learned that the surface temperature of the sun can be found by many methods. First of all, Wien's displacement can be used as the peak in the solar spectrum is easy to identify at 483 nanometer. The temperature is found to be 6000 Kelvin. Then the second approach is to use Stefan Boltzmann law as the luminosity and the radius of the sun can be found independently. These values were reported in the last module. The estimated temperature using this approach was 5768 Kelvin. The third method is to fit various blackbody curves to the observed solar spectrum and choose the one that fits the best. The best fit gives the effective solar surface temperature to be as 5777 Kelvin. We defined in previous modules what is called the color index of a star. Assuming that the star emits like a black body, the color index can be related to the stellar surface temperature. The color index of the sun has been estimated to be 0.653, which translates to the solar surface temperature of 5770 Kelvin. The fourth method is to fit various black body curves. The reason that all these temperatures differ is the assumption that the sun radiates like a black body. However, this assumption is very close to reality, but the appearance of dark lines in the spectrum shows that the sun is not exactly a black body. Taking account of all these factors, the effective surface temperature of the sun has been assigned a value of 5778 Kelvin. The layer of the sun that radiates all the energy that we receive is called the photosphere. The quoted solar surface temperature is the temperature of this layer. The sun is a main sequence star. It burns hydrogen in its core. As long as hydrogen is available in the core, there is little change in its luminosity and temperature. When hydrogen is completely exhausted, the nuclear reactions in the core of the sun will cease. It will expand, its temperature will decrease, but its luminosity will increase as the R square factor will overcome the T to the power 4 factor in the Stefan Boltzmann law. There are two more layers of the sun of the photosphere. These layers are very faint and are visible only when the bright disk of the sun is blocked as during total solar eclipse. These layers are called chromosphere and corona. Chromosphere is about 2000 km thick, the temperature high enough for it to emit emission lines. While corona is a very extensive structure, at times it may extend to the Earth. Its temperature is a few million degrees Kelvin. At this temperature, many atoms are ionized multiple times. Lines of Fe13 are an important feature of the coronal spectrum. Thank you.